Excellency, Mario Paredes, or Mario, thank you very much for those words of introduction. And you all are most welcome here this evening for this conversation about the foundations of the papacy of Pope Francis. And thank you, Your Excellency, for being a part of this.
Thank you.
I want to ask you, who is Jorge Mario Bergoglio, and explore all of those issues, but I would be remiss if I did not ask first, in light of what has transpired in the American church this summer, and the sorrow and the anger and the sadness that affects the people of God in this country. I know that you are the Pope's spokesperson, and the Pope has not spoken directly about these matters, and so you are limited in what you can say, but can you tell us, in some sense, does the Pope appreciate the gravity of the crisis among the people of God here, and how he might begin to go about addressing it?
Well, certainly you spoke about the sorrow, the anger, and I know that the Holy Father is very much aware and about the feeling of the people, you know, people at large in this country, in the world, by the way. It's not just in this country, but also in the church. And I think he shares exactly this feeling. So he has also showed already, you know, don't forget that his first, as soon as, he, you know, the concern was expressed, he gave this message to the people of God, which expresses very well, you know, in depth, these feelings. So, as you say, you know, I will not break news today because this is not my work, and I have to remain discreet. You understand that. But certainly, you know, I know that as he has been doing, he's been doing, you know, in other countries. We have other examples in South America, particularly. The Holy Father wants really the church and the people of the church and all of us, you know, to become much aware of the problems we share. You know, it does not mean that some progress has not been made. I think it's not easy to say that, but we realize that we are not at the end of the road, and we have still a lot to do. I know the concern of the Holy Father and his collaborators and the bishops of this country. They are working hard together. You know, I know that the bishops had a meeting with the Pope a few days ago. And certainly what they want is to help the church to become more aware of the situations, the gravity of the situation, but also to instill some hope. And the hope will come not just through words, but through action. As far as we are concerned, as far as I am concerned, as a priest, as a bishop, and I think this is shared by the bishops I know and the priests, you know, we are all invited to a deep conversion, to a deep conversion which should also be seen by the people, especially because the attitude of some priests, some bishops, is a motive of scandal, you know, and we have to repair. But also I think we have to help the people, you know, to not to lose faith and hope in the church, because we cannot survive without church.
How do we do that, do you think?
Well, you know, I think all of us, we have to work hard, you know, but also, you know, there are several solutions. I will not enter into the details, I think. But, you know, you have technical solutions, the law, etc., the information, but also, I think, the conversion. And I think it's so important. Because we are all, you know, yeah, there is a kind of big solidarity inside the church. And, you know, if some of us have been cause of scandals, we are all concerned by that, you know. And we, instead of always condemning the other, and putting our fingers on others, you know, what we are, which is, we are all invited to see us, and what about me? What about us? What are we actually doing to restore the trust, you know? It's not enough to say we have lost trust or to the bishops, to the priests, to the, you know, to the sinners. But by the way, we are all sinners. I think we should not forget about that, you know. This is not an excuse to the sin, but, you know, we are actually in the church. And Pope Francis tells us that there is a dimension in the church which is part of his message, and I would say part of its foundation. It's also the mercy. The mercy is not excusing what's going badly, but the mercy is also an instrument of redemption, because it comes not from us, but from God himself, who is merciful.
And as you say, there are technical solutions that are required, and there is a spiritual one, which is this conversion of ourselves, the acknowledgement that we are sinners. And we saw the U.S. bishops today, their administration committee made a very strong statement about some of the technical solutions that they're proposing.
But I think it's true, you know, we have to find ways and means, and they are very important. And we have to discover them, because at times we are lost in front of the amplitude of the problems.
Right.
But on the other hand, you know, we should also work hard for that, you know. But we know also that these means, technical, legal, and so forth, education, I think the aspect of education is so important, but they will never be enough. We have seen that, because in the past we have made some progress, but we realize that the progress is not complete, and it will never be complete, by the way. So it's an endless story.
And that's really the tragedy, is the sense of that that we had made some progress, and perhaps we were naive in thinking that this was all behind us, because it deals with the reality of human sin.
Yeah, and, exactly. You know, but you
both
know,
this, personal and systematic.
But this is not just a problem of the church, but this is a problem of all societies, of all aspects of society. You know, we all experience it in our families. You know, things are never resolved forever. We have to struggle every day to find new solutions. This is, we are on the way, and Christ has come into this world justement not to condemn the world, but for the process of salvation and redemption. Yeah. And the redemption is a long process, precisely, you know. But we have also, it is not an automatic process. We are called to collaborate, to enter into this process of redemption and to participate to it. But there is, as we experience it, all of us in our own life, personal life, but also in the life of our communities, in the life of the church, there are a lot of resistance and a lot of weaknesses. And nobody say that the weakness is just in the life of the other, even if there is sometimes a motive of big scandal, because we see some people falling, you know, and some people were respected and we trusted, you know. But it's also an invitation for all of us not to lose trust, you know. The church is much more than each one of us. But also the church is also each one of us. This is the mystery of incarnation of the Lord.
Well, and we came here tonight to talk about who is Jorge Mario Bergoglio, who is Pope Francis. And I was mindful as you were speaking about the fact that when we published this famous interview with Father Spadaro in the pages of America Magazine, the first question that Father Spadaro asked him was, who is Jorge Mario Bergoglio? And he said, I am a sinner. That is how he began that interview.
Yes.
And because it seems to me that he is mindful that conversion of which you speak is at the very center of who he is.
Exactly.
So who is this man, Jorge Mario Bergoglio, that is, and what are the resources of his spiritual, his intellectual life that he's going to bring to bear to face these crises and the future of the church?
Well, it's really, it's interesting to discover. I would say, you know, the Pope, Pope Francis, Pope Bergoglio, is a person who we should actually try to discover better. You know, I think to understand his person and his action, I think we really need to to see the context, you know, of his election. Maybe also, we don't know exactly, the Holy Spirit works in a strange way, but the Holy Spirit is never outside the reality, you know.
Right.
And I think this is the mystery, again, the mystery of the incarnation of our Lord, you know. So, you know, I think Pope Bergoglio was elected Pope at a moment of big change in the world. You know, he likes to repeat, and I think this is a quotation of his first document, you know, the Evangelii Gaudium, the joy of the gospel. Joy of the gospel, by the way, you know, this is also very meaningful. You know that in a time of which so many people consider as we're in a pessimistic way, all the documents of the Holy Father speaks about the joy. Joy of love, joy of the gospel, you know, exultate and so forth. You know, the joy to be called to holiness and so forth. So there is a sentence that we are living in a change of time, you know. And for that, I think it's important to make reference to a very important event in the life of the church in South America, but this event is about, with the election of Pope Francis, has taken a kind of world dimension, the Conference of Aparecida. You know about it, of course. You know this, during the last century, the South American bishops, you know, big number of countries, churches in South America, have had a number of conferences, five conferences, yeah. And these conferences have given the possibility to these various churches to work together and to have a kind of common identity. So the fifth one was in Aparecida, Brazil. You know, this is the big sanctuary of Our Lady of Aparecida. This meeting was in May 2007. I personally was appointed as nuncio at that moment, and I arrived at the end of this meeting. So I was able to see the bishops from Mexico coming from this meeting of Aparecida, and the first document I read when I arrived in Mexico, coming from Africa, you know, it's a kind of change of culture, was the final document of Aparecida. And I was astounded and very interested to see the kind of analysis of the situation.
Which then Archbishop Bergoglio had, he was one of the chief drafters.
Exactly. You know, then I discovered that. But I remember a number of bishops from Mexico was telling me, you know, there was somebody, you know, in our midst who was the person who helped us to think about the situations, but also to write about it. And the thinking was that, you know, he asked a question, what are we living as pastors? You know, what is our main concern? Instead of coming and, you know, writing a document which was, as in this conference, is written by experts, they say, we are the experts. The pastors are the experts. I think it's important. You know?
They're the closest to the ground, to the people.
Because they receive the feeling of their people, their priests, the parents, the teachers, the politicians, you know, the priests. And so they said, and they say it at the beginning of this document, they said, you know, we are all of us, we are living in a kind of existential crisis because we don't know how to transmit our values and our faith. And this is particular, of course, to the society of South America, where the culture was very much in harmony and coherence with the faith, you know, because
it was Catholic culture.
Right. The culture was actually helping the people traditionally, you know, to receive the values and the faith. So the parents, you know, were transmitting that to their children, the teachers, and suddenly there is a kind of breakdown of communication, which is not the usual difficulty from one generation to the other, which has always existed. It's something which is deeper, and it affects precisely our work as priests, as evangelizers. Yeah. And they said, the explications are very complex, you know, this is a long story, but we are living in a globalized world, the role of the medias, there is a new relativism, you know. So basically, the parents, for example, had a difficulty to, they said, but what happens? I have done my best, but my children have not received what I wanted to receive them. And the priests are like that, and the teachers in particular, you know. Mm-hmm. They don't know what to teach, by the way. Because, and you remember what also Pope Benedict said about the dictature of relativism, you know. So it means that there are no real values. And so what should we give to the people today? And this affects particularly the church. Because the church, the job, the function of the church is to transmit.
Right. So when you speak of this change of time, that that is the context in which the Pope came to,
exactly.
to the Vatican. It's really a change in all of the social and political and cultural conditions
exactly.
in which the evangelization of the church takes place.
So precisely that, you know, so that the evangelization is not being done as it used to be, you know. And he says, how could we, because our mission is to evangelize, how could we actually do it in this new context? And my feeling, my view is that this is the key of Pope Francis.
Why?
And this is the key in the sense that he invites us, you know, to become aware about new situations, change of time, which may be different from in South America, in North America, in Asia, in Africa. But, you know, I can tell you that I've been myself lived in 10 countries. And all over the place, I think we have living in different ways, but the same experience. So the Pope, who has actually reflected about that in his Latin American context, in his Argentinian context, is offering that to the world. But there is also another aspect, you know. Then the bishops, they didn't just make a diagnosis of the situation. They wanted to offer some answers, because our mission is to evangelize.
Right.
How could we evangelize in this context? So he said, what is the role of the church? The church is the place, should be, and where we are invited to make a personal encounter with Jesus.
A personal encounter.
Personal encounter, a real encounter, an experience of Christ. So we are not just transmitting ideas or ideologies, you know. And in a time of crisis, the temptation could be precisely, you know, to say that, you know, at least we have to keep these ideas, these ideologies, these doctrines. But it's very important, of course, to keep the doctrines. But if we have not discovered personally the reasons for the adoption of these doctrines, I think the whole thing just collapsed. So the Pope, the bishops in Aparecida said, let's go and become again, you know, reinventing a church where there is a possibility to make a personal encounter with Christ. And for that, you know, we need to help our people precisely to make this encounter.
Right.
But this encounter cannot be made in a theoretical way, you know.
And that is really the key, isn't it? Because
that's the key, in my opinion, which helps us to understand, you know, the actions, the attitude, and the teaching of the Pope. Then right. We could go on.
You're right, because the crisis itself, as you say, the larger sort of epochal crisis, is precisely in a collapse of the means of transmission of the faith.
Exactly.
And what Francis, as Archbishop Bergoglio and his colleagues did, was they came in and they said, actually, that's the wrong question. The better question is, what are we actually transmitting?
Exactly.
And if we are transmitting simply a set of ideas,
yes,
then they're going to be received in a quite cheap way, because ideas are quite plentiful.
Actually,
right?
In an atmosphere of relativism, you know,
right.
Where there is a crisis of the truth today, you know, in all areas of the society, you know, a lot of people say, you know, well, but this idea is relative.
Yeah.
What makes this idea the truth? And, you know, the truth is Jesus. I am the truth.
Right.
You know?
Right.
If we have not had the possibility to have a personal encounter, to discover that Jesus is the truth, what would be the criteria of the truth, by the way? So
right, yeah.
That's the function of the church. The church is there for that, no? Not just to sell ideas or principles, you know? The principle will come later, you know? As a result of this personal encounter, you know?
Right, right. And that is also one of the reasons why Pope Francis is so concerned about the influence of ideology.
Exactly.
I noticed recently that in three homilies within the first 2 months of his election as Pope, he mentions this problem. It's also mentioned in the Separatista document of which you speak. I've seen in the United States our response to this crisis over the summer and to a number of other ecclesial events. A lot of the commentary tends to be structured by ideology.
Yeah.
What does the Pope mean when he says that ideology is a danger? And first of all, what does he mean by ideology? And secondly, why is it such of a concern?
Well, you know, you remember there is also a beautiful sentence at the beginning of the very important document, you know, encyclical of Pope Benedict, by the way, because, you know, it's the number one of Caritas in Veritate. And, you know, our faith, I don't know if I have it by memory, but I think it's a very important one. Our faith is not, you know, an idea, an ideology, but an encounter with a person, an event, which opens to us a new horizon in life, right. You know, and gives us a new freedom, you know. So this is really, and this sentence has been recopied by Pope Francis in his Evangelii Gaudium, and it is being repeated over and over, and I think it's the key to the problem, you know. The ideology is, you know, a kind of idea which you extract from the reality, but then you become, because of worshipping of this idea, and you apply the idea upon the reality.
Which
distorts the reality, because then you believe more in the idea than the reality. So I think we have to recreate the contact. And the reality for us is the person of Christ. Right. The person of Christ incarnated in our life, you know? So at the gospel, precisely, the gospel is the instrument for the encounter with Jesus. But the gospel is also the way for us to apply it, you know, it's to apply it to our life, to make it life in our own existence, you know. So the Holy Father is not against doctrines and so forth, you know. After, he says the priority is there. So, for example, you know, a Christian in Aparecida, the bishop says, you know, we are all called to become disciples of Jesus and missionaries of his presence. Yeah. So I think we act as disciples. Yeah. And the disciple is the one who listens to the words, follow the example of Jesus, and applies his own life. And this will have consequences, his own life. But then you will have the respect of human life, from the conception to the end, the attention to the poor, all these elements of which could characterize a Christian. But you are not Catholic because you are pro-life. You are pro-life because you are disciple of Jesus. And as disciple of Jesus, of course,
right. And
you cannot miss not being pro-life, you know?
How important is that distinction?
Yeah, I think it's crucial.
Yeah.
It's crucial, and because you know it's the source of it, you know.
Yeah.
Because the Pope says quite often that we are not an NGO.
Right.
You know, you are not an human organization, even if as a church we are organized, we are committed. You know, we are. This is not the first. You know, this is the consequence. And we should never lose the link between one and the other, you know? Mm-hmm. Otherwise, we could be a lobby in the society, But the church is not just a lobby, even if it is important for the church to be a lobby. You know, the church is not just a political organization, even if it is important for the Christians to be involved in politics. You know, so it's a question of priority, but it's crucial. Because if we forget the source, we forget about the source of life, you know? And then the church becomes mundane. This is also one of the key words of, you know, used quite often. And even the priest, you know, the priests are helping the people to be related to Jesus. And for that, you know, they need to be, as all Christians, you know, to be a model of life, right. You know, and to live a life
in a conscious living relationship.
Exactly,
with Jesus
exactly. You know,
first. Right.
So this is the reason why, you know, there is so much scandal when somebody is not living what he's supposed to live. You know, but this applies not just to the priest, to all of us. You know, the coherence between what you believe and what you do in the family. The father, if the father is not a model of life for his children, you know, the children will see that. You know, mm-hmm. At the end, it's a question of witness.
So the context is this change of time in which the means by which the faith has been traditionally transmitted have collapsed or are somehow imperiled. And Pope Francis comes along and says, actually, what we need to actually focus on what is the content. And he says it's not an idea, it's a person, and it's that personal encounter with the Lord. And he actually says also in that interview with Father Spadaro, he says what is absolutely crucial is that first proclamation of the Church: Jesus Christ has saved you, not an idea, not a philosophy, not a priest, not a bishop. Jesus Christ Himself, the person, has saved you.
Well, you know, I think it has always been like that, by the way. Mm-hmm. But the context is different. Mm-hmm. You know, I think in a context, I remember, you know, in Mexico, for example, which may be culturally was one of the most Catholic countries in the world, you know, where the culture and the faith was very strongly associated. You know, you were born in this society, you became a Catholic straight away. Because, you know, in the family you had the practice of the sacraments, the prayer of the family, you know, the pilgrimages, the devotion to Our Lady of Guadalupe. You know, there is a cultural context which provides to the young generation, to the people, the possibility to connect with the mystery of God's presence in our life. You know, this is when the sacraments are being actually lived, you know, with devotion, with intensity, when the child sees that the father is able, you know, every night to say the rosary in the house. You know, in my family, you know, we used to have prayer every night, you know. So as a child, I saw my father and my mother praying. And their prayer was not just something, you know, it was real.
Right.
So the communication was made naturally. Of course, you know, I had to rediscover myself. But does it exist today? You know, in this new context, you know. Now, it's not, there are all other, the world does not provide that. Mm. So the Pope is fully aware of that. And he said, we have to evangelize today.
Yes.
We cannot dream about yesterday. Mm-hmm. Yesterday was different, you know. And so we have to reinvent things. Some people don't necessarily understand that. They said, well, but, you know, let's think about yesterday. But yesterday does not exist anymore.
Right. Right. Yes. There is a strain of commentary in the ecclesial conversation that sounds like the ghost of Christmas past. Yeah. But there is a you know, I really identify with something you said, because I always say that what I inherited from my own mother was her joy, the joy that came from her faith, and that I think is probably why, apart from the fact that so many lives have been devastated and damaged by people's actions, that the crises in the church, they compromise our ability to testify to that joy, don't they?
Yes.
In some way.
Well, it's true.
Yeah.
But we know it's also, we have also to have a strong reaction.
Yeah.
And the reaction cannot come from outside, by the way. And we cannot just be paralyzed, even by critics and so forth, you know, even if they are very powerful and, you know, and we are all touched. But we have also to play our part, you know, all of us, you know, and I hope, you know, this will be an opportunity, you know, to go ahead, you know. I think it's so important.
Yeah. How important is how important are two things to Pope Francis's worldview: the fact that he is a Jesuit, mm-hmm. and the fact that he is a South American.
He's a South American. Well, the Jesuit. Well,
I'd answer, but I'm biased.
You should say that, you know. Yeah.
I don't want to be accused of Jesuit hubris.
But I tell you, because, yeah. You know, they think they know everything the Jesuit is not doing. you know, I think it's providential. I have always considered, you know, that the election of this post is providence. Maybe a lot of Catholics today don't think that. But some said they are a bit disappointed because they don't understand him. But, you know, don't forget, if we are Catholics, you know, we believe in the way the Catholic Church works. But the Holy Spirit is part of the election of a Pope. You know? We cannot dream about the post of the Pope, the Pope of the past, you know, and not even a Pope, the so-called Pope of the future. We have... You know, we have this. So, okay, you know that. It's obvious. Huh? This is obvious. Huh? But, you know, the fact that Bergoglio is a Jesuit, you know, look, in this time where we need a lot of discernment, precisely, the discernment is a key word. And maybe the main characteristic of Pope Francis is a man who is able to discern. And a real Christian should be a good person of discernment.
Yeah. What is that? Know, what is discernment?
Well, discernment, what is it? You know, it's the capacity to analyze the situation in the light of Christ and the Spirit, you know? And, you know, the Jesuits, they have a wonderful instrument, which is traditional in the church. You know, the exercises of St. Ignatius of Loyola, yeah? And they are a wonderful instrument of discernment in the light of Christ and the gospel. If you have had the opportunity, you know, to practice this exercise. And, you know, the Jesuit Bergoglio was, you know, as good Jesuits. I hope the Jesuits of today are like that, because he's a young one, you know. I think he has been educated in the light with the exercises. But he has also been a master of the exercise. You know, so the method, you know, the method, the exercise has been really part of his life. And, you know, he actually applies them to his, now as a Pope. Some people told me that he's like a spiritual director of the humanity. So which is very interesting, you know. This is the reason why so many people go and see him. You know, so that's why I think I'm a bit puzzled by the fact that so many people criticize him, but probably because they don't fully understand. You know, so many people go and see him, and you know, just to have a kind of light, you know, in this difficult time, which at times is not difficult, it's not easy to understand. You know, and we need really this big capacity of discernment. Of course, there is no discernment if he's not, you know, listening to the Spirit, the prayer. You know, Pope Bergoglio is a man of prayer, by the way. You know, prayer is part of his life. He's a busy man, but he has never forgotten the prayer, you know. It's not just a small prayer like that, you know.
Right.
He's a man of prayer. I've accompanied him for 5 days, you know, when I was not in Mexico, you know. I saw that. I saw the presence, you know. The man is present to the reality. He's discerning all the time, you know. He's in touch with the reality. He has no idea already made before he sees the things. You know, this is For me, this is the experience of the Jesuits, you know?
Right.
Maybe the providence is working at that. To have chosen somebody who has this capacity, this experience, and this patrimony of, you know, the Jesuits and the spiritual exercise to precisely to guide the church in this difficult time. That's what I think.
Especially since, I mean, if it's true that the larger context is this this shift in time and the change in the means of transmission of the faith, and that what is required is for us to remember that it's about a personal encounter with the Lord. Yeah. The spiritual exercises is a means of doing that.
Yeah, right?
That's precisely what it is, and many people, I think, they often associate the Jesuits with our many years of training and all of these degrees and all the rest. But the secret is that the secret sauce is the spiritual exercises. Like that is what makes us who we are.
But
I've also heard from some folks that sometimes they feel like that Pope Francis is trying to turn us all into Jesuits. I mean, do you think that that's just a ridiculous claim? That his worldview is so Ignatian that...
Well, I don't mind.
I'm not complaining either.
No. It's part, you know, this is one of the great saints of the church, you know?
Yeah.
But he's not the only one, of course, you know?
Right.
But don't forget that, you know... All of us, in our training, we have been, in some way, trained with the spiritual exercise. You know, I remember when I entered into the major seminary, I was 17, you know, going out of my home. And after 1 month, our spiritual director said, now you will have 1 month of spiritual exercise. You know, and, you know, it marked my life.
Yeah.
You know, 4 weeks, you know, of retreat with precisely, you know, this kind of... We enter into a personal contact with Jesus, but you know, not just a kind of hairy contact. You know, it's not, you know, just a concrete way. How is your life in relationship with the gospel every day? You know, it's, you know, we had 5 hours of contemplation every day for 1 month. You know,
yes.
This is what the spirit.
Yep. Yeah. I remember.
And you know, we're guided by a spiritual director. You know, every night you had the contact with a spiritual director. This is a serious business, you know?
Yeah. Yes, it is, yeah.
You know, now in the enterprises, you know, the managers, they bring their people in very posh hotels, you know, on the beach and make spiritual meditations and contemplation, which it's useless. This is the real training.
Yeah. I mean, I thought so, and the thing that that folks will also say is okay, that he's engaged in this art of discernment and he's living a life of the exercises, and it can be a little messy. You know, he's giving interviews. He's he's not always speaking in paragraphs with a systematic thought. Mm-hmm. You know, he's comfortable with the messiness of life. Mm. So they sometimes criticize him for not being an intellectual heavyweight.
Yes,
you think that's fair?
I heard that critics. You know, some people said, you know, first of all, he's a South American, so you know. And then, you know, is he a real theologian? So they oppose him to Pope Benedict, who was, you know, the real German theologian. So, but you know, if you read the writings of Pope Francis, not just as a pope, but before, you know, and there are plenty of them, you will be astounded by the depth and the capacity of, you know, analysis and synthesis. You know, I am a diplomat myself. You know, we are trained, you know, to make papers, and we said that a good diplomat should be able to analyze quickly and to synthesize and to transmit. You know, this is how you feel the real intellectual, is it? And this is Pope Francis, by the way. But you know, when you realize that what has been his formation, you know, he is a real theologian. You know, I There was I read a book last year, you know, written by an Italian author called Massimo Borghese.
Ah, yes.
And I think I
had Mr. Sawicki has a,
you know, and by the way, this book will be translated in English in October. Yeah. So I recommend you to read this book. It's very interesting. You know, so it is a kind of deep analysis about the authors of the formation, which have contributed to the formation of Pope Francis. And you know, he's well educated, I can tell you. He's well educated, not just because he has read a lot of authors, but because he has assimilated them. You know, he's not the type of professor like, you know, who has just written a few books, you know, of treatises of theology. This is different kind of person, but he is the man of action. But the man of action who has actually read a lot of, and is aware about all the philosophers and theologians of the last century, you know? And if you read that book, you will realize that the big one, the important ones, you know, have contributed to his formation. But, you know, the real intellectual in the context of today should be like that. You know? We don't need intellectuals who are just, you know, theoricians about that. You know, okay, you have them in universities, you need some specialists, but he's a man of action. And the Lord has sent him to govern the church. The bishops and the Pope, they have no time just to write books and so forth. You know, some exceptionally do. For example, Pope Benedict, even when he was a Pope, he wrote 3 or 4 books about Jesus. But, you know, he had a kind of patrimony of knowledge. But, you know, what is interesting is that all the authors he has studied and assimilated, you know, and you start from Gaston Fessard, you know, one of the big specialists about Hegel, you know. That was the first author he studied. Then Romano Guardini, which helps him, you know, a German who helps him to deepen the kind of polarity of thinking. And then the great theologian, Urs von Balthasar, de Lubac, Congar, you know, all the great theologians of the time have contributed to his formation. But you see the influence of these authors in his writing and in his homilies and his analysis, and they are quite interesting. So I think, personally, I think this is the reason why in such a complexity of the world, he's not losing track, precisely because he has instrument to reflect, to deepen, and to preach.
Right.
You know, and of course that's the aspect. But yeah, there is also this Latin American background. You know, the Latin American background is also very important in his formation because he is a Latin American. You know, and yes, there are a number of authors who are not well known, especially in this country, because right. You know, you are living in different contexts. But these people have been huge intellectuals. For example, there is a philosopher and theologian called Metol Ferry, yeah, who was a good friend of Pope Francis, and also a lady who was, a philosopher, you know, who has had a big influence in his formation, you know.
Right.
And these people now are better known precisely because of Pope Francis, but they were already known in South America. He was also instrumental to help, you know, to redress the problems of liberation theology. You remember liberation theology in South America, you know?
Right.
And there was, at some stage, you know, liberation theology was geared toward Marxism, but you know, in the silence of a small group of people with Metol Ferry and so forth, you know, they imaginated a new kind of theology based also on the option for the poor, but not falling into the defect of embracing Marxism as such. You know, so this also has been the contribution of Pope Francis, and the document of Aparecida precisely is the fruit of that.
Right. Yeah. So he has a context. Yes. He has a method, which is the discernment and the art of the spiritual exercises. Does he have a plan? What does this man of action really want to do?
Well, this is interesting. You know, I remember when I arrived in Mexico, there was a bishop who is actually, who is now the cardinal archbishop of the city of Mexico, you know, he's called Carlos Aguiar. So he's also quite an intellectual. And he was one of the redactors with Cardinal Bergoglio of the final document of Aparecida. Mm-hmm. And I remember 11 years ago, he told me that, you know. When Pope Francis was actually elected, but he had also, before he had spoken to me about Cardinal Bergoglio, and he said, you know, be careful. He knows exactly where to go. You know? But what he wants is not just a predetermined plan, you know, but precisely he wants to have a church responding to the challenges of the time, but being church, which is the place where it is possible to have a personal encounter with Jesus. Mm. This is what he wants,
right.
You know? So at times, you know, this plan may be a bit unsettling for a lot of people, but this is what he wants.
And also it's not going to be, I presume, a detailed instruction, because how you facilitate that kind of personal encounter with the Lord its core remains the same, but might vary from cultural context.
I think we have enough documents now to testify that the direction is that, you know?
Yeah.
Take the Evangelii Gaudium, the love, you know, the joy of love, take Gaudete and Exultate, which are, in my opinion, the three documents which gives this precisely orientation of the Pope, and the actions, you know? For example, the fact that the first synod was about the family precisely goes deep into the crisis of the time. The crisis of the time affects first and foremost the family. But now, you know, the second synod is about the youth and the education of the youth, you know, and the vocation. So, you know, the two synods, the three main documents, you know, goes in that direction. It shows that it is a kind of concrete answer to the need of the time and the necessity to evangelize. I would say this is the line.
Right, right. One of our questioners points out that he's a Jesuit, and this is an important part of his identity, but he chose the name of Francis.
Yeah.
I suppose Ignatius would have been a little spot on for people's tastes. But what that's another element of his worldview, isn't it? This Francis. Why Francis?
You know, he's a Jesuit because he has a method and he has an identity. But he's not sectarian. So he's, you know, he's attentive to. And, you know, he chose Francis because of the poor.
Yeah.
Because of the necessity, you know. Remember when he was elected, his companion, Cardinal from Brazil, said, don't forget the poor, you know. So I think Pope Francis has been very coherent on that. You know, remember when the first, you know, when he went to Lampedusa,
right.
But also this idea of going to the peripheries, you know, all these elements and the attention to the poor, you know. He does not give up. I tell you, he's very determined.
Yeah.
I've seen that myself in my own experience.
Right.
You
right.
cannot fool him.
There is another question from somebody in our audience. It says, is there a difference between Francis's style and Pope Benedict's style in their approach to the papacy and to the problems of the world?
Yes. Yes and no.
It's very diplomatic.
No, I think, yes, well, it's obvious, you know, we can observe that. Mm-hmm. But, you know, I would say there is a continuity. And precisely, I see the continuity with this sentence I quoted before, you know.
I'm sorry.
Because the sentence, I quoted, you know, Caritas in Veritate. Right. I think people, you know, maybe some people who are not very happy with Pope Francis, so they dream about Francis, you know?
Or Benedict.
We should be very careful, you know. At times our feelings are overwhelming. So instead of looking at the reality as it is, you know, we judge the reality from our own feeling or resentments or disappointments, you know. And then we say, okay, you know, this Pope, I don't understand him, but much better. We dream about, you know, the other. But, you know, each Pope comes at a certain time. And that's it, you know, and we believe in the Church. This is what we say when we say the Credo, you know. I believe the Holy Catholic Church, and that's it.
Right. What is the significance of Pope Francis? He mentioned, when he came to the U.S., he spoke to the U.S. Congress, and he mentioned several people, several Americans, that he held up as models. And one of them was Dorothy Day. She's a favorite of America Magazine's readers, and especially. But what is the why did he choose those people? Do you think it was Abraham Lincoln, Martin Luther King, Dorothy Day?
Maybe you could answer the question better. Dorothy Day, I don't know her very well personally, but you know what I've discovered is that
because there's a cause underway.
Yes. Mm-hmm. You know, the dimension of conversion in our life. This is very, very striking, you know. A person who has had a very difficult life, like all our lives, by the way, you know. But a person who has been able to change her life because of encounter with Christ. I think this is precisely what fascinating Dorothy. But also her commitment to the poor.
Yeah.
You know, I think these are, in my opinion, the two dimensions. You know,
yeah. I would say a third that perhaps Frances was not conscious of, but why I think she's a saint for our time is that she witnessed to the radical nature of the gospel.
Exactly.
Which was neither left nor right, but radical. Exactly.
Yeah. Right. And that's the crux of her conversion, by the way.
Yeah.
You know, she abandons ideologies and she relies to the person. And this changed her life.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. That, in a sense, it's her encounter with the Lord, she encounters someone who subverts all of our notions of power.
Exactly. Right. That's conversion, by the way. Yeah. You know, the conversion from the encounter is so powerful that we think that we cannot just rely on ideas or ideology. We need to go deeper for that. You know?
Right. Mm. Right. So what do you think is next in this process of reorienting the pastoral priorities of the Church?
Well, you know, I think you know, the task is not easy. You know, I think it's true. You know, I would say the Pope will continue. You know, he is continuing. I think he also wants, you know, there are several aspects. The invitation to a personal conversion. You remember in Evangelii Gaudium, you know, there is a kind of, he speaks a lot about personal conversion and pastoral conversion, you know. But, you know, and he also gives a lot of importance to the pastoral conversion to the Church, so that the Church may become an instrument of encounter with Christ and personal conversion. And this is also his effort, you know, to change, to help the Church to be more adapted to her mission, not just to adapt it to the times, because a lot of people say that, you know, it's a kind of mundanization of the Church. No. Adapt it so that it may be at the service of the encounter with Jesus and the conversion of the people. You know, and this is, for example, you know, you have a synod in October.
Yeah.
But a couple of days ago, you know, the Pope published a new status of the synod. And he wants a church which become more collegial. But to organize the collegiality is not an easy job.
Right. You know?
Collegiality means participation, you know. Participation, but not just pure democracy. No, it's not because the church is not there. But, you know, participation of all members of the church. So that when there are problems, so that we share the missions. How to do that? It's not easy,
right.
You know? In the respect of the particularity and the vocation and the mission of each member, the bishops, the priests, the religious, the lay people, but all together, but it has to be organized. He has also, you know, a big fight to get what he called clericalism,
right.
Which for him, is one of the source of this abuse of power, of all these problems we have today, you know, and he wants...
He sees that clearly as part
he has
of
said that,
the
you know,
problem.
And, you know, in this last letter to the people, God's people, he said that, you know. What is clericalism? It's basically when those who have the priests, you know, kind of people who isolate themselves from God's people.
Mm-hmm.
So we are priests and bishops and deacons, and all, you know, all those who have a responsibility in the church should be at the service of the church. And not their power is more responsibility than exercise of power, not to isolate themselves, to be in touch with the reality, and to be true witness of God's love, you know, to the people, to the mercy of God. So this is a big fight.
Right.
But this is, I think, what the Pope wants to continue to do.
And does that reform in the Pope's mind, that change in the culture of clericalism, does that also require a conversion that's not just spiritual but technical?
Yes, I would say, you know. I think it's a change of attitude from our side, you know,
right.
with the priest, but it's also a change of attitude in the lay people, mm-hmm. you know, so that we learn to relate to one another in the respect of who we are, but in full collaboration for the service of the church, you know. We don't isolate each other, you know, we are servants.
Right.
I think it's so important. You know, at times, you know, people may say, you know, I will help my parish priest, you know, in the parish. No, I'm helping my parish priest. No, you are not helping your parish priest. The parish priest is helping you.
Right.
You know, this is a kind of change of mentality, you know. But it should also be turned into action, into the way we are organizing our institutions, our parishes, our dioceses, so that we are at the service of evangelization.
Right.
This is also, there is something which the Pope said from the very beginning, you know, the church should go out, not be inward looking.
Right.
So these are our key words of Pope Francis, and I think we need to transform them in our mentality and in our way of living.
Yeah, he warns against that kind of narcissism.
Yes,
that can plague the church, and it seems to me that in a time of crisis like we've had, where people are sorrowful, rightly angry, and so forth, that's what they're looking for is action. Action.
Mm-hmm.
And but as you point out, the Pope has a method of discernment.
Yeah.
And what he's most concerned about is taking the right action, mm-hmm. not necessarily the fastest
exactly.
one.
Exactly. You know, I think also we are living in a time where you know, all leaders are constantly, you know, submitted to the pressure of the medias.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they want quite cancer. You know, what do you think? What is your opinion? And so, okay. But, you know, the Pope is not just answering. He's not a politician.
Right. Right.
You know, he's not just working for votes. You know, he has something different, you know. And he has a mission to accomplish, and a responsibility. I would say, you know, the idea of responsibility is so important today. So responsibility to what?
And what is the answer?
Well, you know, I think we need to know to value our responsibility. You know, if, for example, if you are a professor in the school,
right.
What is your responsibility? You know? Is it just Is it just to teach English or computer science and that's it? Or have you got also a responsibility to educate? You know?
Yeah.
And if you are a priest, you know, are you just to say what you have? You have the responsibility to raise the church in the reality. You know, you are a bishop. So, if you are a parent, you know, how do you see your the education of a child? Which kind of values you want to transmit? This is part of our responsibility. You know, it goes very far, and at times we remain very superficial.
Yeah.
In what we do, we are happy with very very little things, but because and we risk to do a bad job.
Discernment also requires dialogue, doesn't it?
Yes.
And that's something that the Pope has talked a lot about,
yes.
Dialogue.
Yes.
Now, he's been criticized for this because people will ask, well, dialogue to what end?
Exactly.
So, but how does he answer that?
Well, you know, I think it's, again, you know, I think it's true. You know, the Pope is also, in today's world, you know, we need a lot of dialogue. First of all, we have to live together, you know. You mentioned at the beginning, you know, the importance of peace, you know, and we have also to learn to know the other, to respect the other, and the dialogue is an instrument for that. But which kind of dialogue, you know?
Right.
Dialogue is not just talk and talk, you know. It's also taking the responsibility to be myself for the other, not to ignore ourselves. You know, the temptation today is to isolate ourselves, you know, to build walls instead of bridges. You know, we know that. And this is all over the place, you know. And why? Because we don't want to talk to the other. And because the other is fearful.
Right.
You know, so it's better to isolate myself and to say, no, I don't want. But in which world are we living?
Right.
So I think it's a value which the Pope is promoting a lot.
Well, I'm getting the signal from the back. I should say that I did review all of your questions, and of course a number of them had to do with the events of the last summer. And when I invited the nuncio here to speak, I was mindful of the fact that he's the Pope's spokesperson, and so he can't comment directly on matters that the Pope has not himself commented directly on. But I think that there's also a wonderful question here to end on, which is in the face of these challenges to the Church, which are so profound, which we've been living through here in the U.S., what is it that has given you hope?
You know, what it giving me hope is that, you know, I've now been 2 years in this country, and, you know, I'm traveling all the time. You know, I'm visiting the communities. I'm in touch with the bishops, the priests, you know. What is giving me hope is the reality of the Church today, you know, as I see it. You know. And I think it's so important not to lose track of that. You know, again, you know, at times we are, when there is a lot of noise, a lot of feelings, a lot of anger, which is true, you know, but at times we lose track of the reality of the people, you know. A lot of people are, you know, faithful, prayerful, aware of their calling, their vocation, their mission, their responsibility. You know, they don't get excited about that. You know, they work, you know, in the families, they live. I see that every day, you know. And this is the source of my hope, you know. At times, so we should not lose track of that, you know. I don't say that to diminish the problems, no. But, you know, I have a lot of hope, you know. To be honest with you, I'm very happy to be here, you know. You know, it's very challenging for a person like me, you know, to arrive in such a reality like United States, church with its huge diversity, you know, the big challenges, but also the efforts, you know, to make the church work, you know. Tomorrow morning I'm going to Dallas, you know, and I will stay there 4 days. You are certainly aware about, you know, this very important event. You know, it's the last step of what we call the fifth encuentro, you know, the fifth encounter of the Hispano people. You know, you know that nearly half of the Catholics are of Hispano origin, you know, of different stage. So it's very important. It's very important in this church, in society. And, you know, coming from South America, you know, I worked myself in 4 countries of South America, so I'm very sensitive to that. And I measure, you know, the challenge of this new immigration, this immigration of the Hispano, because it's a challenge, every immigration, but this country is made of immigrants, so you cannot ignore that. But also the difficulties, you know, for the people who come with a different experience of church, of faith, to integrate in this. So they have a lot to offer, and we have a lot to receive from them, you know. And this has been precisely, you know, these 3 years of the fifth encuentro, you know, where at the beginning this analysis and experience of the pastoral of the Hispano people began at the parish level, then at the diocesan level, at the regional level, and tomorrow we will begin at the national level. 3,000 people will gather until Monday, and I will be there myself, because I always want to be there when things happen.
That's very good. And America Magazine will be there, I'm proud to say.
Also, I will meet you there.
J.D. Long Garcia will be there to cover it. And I'm glad to hear that being among the people of God in this country gives you hope. And of course, we're very grateful that you're here. You know, whatever has to happen in the church to face our many challenges, one thing is we really do need to be in dialogue and in conversation with our pastors. And not all archbishops would sit on a stage and answer questions, and you've now done it for us twice, and I thank you for it.
Thank you. So.
My thanks to all of you for coming tonight. And am I supposed to do anything else other than say AmericanMagazine.org? And you're most welcome to join us for some refreshment just down the hallway. Thank you.